Hello, everyone, and welcome this morning to this event, this webinar from Salesforce and Times Higher Education. I'm your moderator today. My name is Joyce Lau. Thank you so much for being with us. The topic today is about how we can help and support student well-being in Australia and New Zealand. I'd just like to start off by handing over for an acknowledgement of country.
Thanks, Joyce. So we would like to begin today by acknowledging the traditional owners of our land on which we meet today and recognize their continuing connection to the land, waters, and culture. So we pay our respects to elders past and present.
Thank you very much. That was Shanaka Jayakobi, Character and Culture for Educators at ShareTree. I'd like to introduce our other panelists. We are joined by Daphne Johal, Director of Education GTM at Salesforce. We're also here with Dean Cece at RMIT, Executive Director of Students, Carrie Valentine, Director of Student Success and Well-being at Bond, Benjamin Wilkes, the Head of Student Well-being at the University of Sydney, and Julia Coyle, Prose Vice Chancellor of Students at the University of Wollongong. Thank you very much for being here. I'm just going to start off by handing over to Daphne of Salesforce, who will take us through a brief presentation.
Great. Thank you so much, Joyce. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. So if you've not heard of Salesforce.org, I'll just give you just a brief overview of the work that we're doing. So we are a part of Salesforce, but what we're really focused on is the education, nonprofit and philanthropic organizations. And we're really focused on being that social impact center of Salesforce as a whole company, making sure that we're helping education institutions, philanthropic organizations and nonprofits to really tackle some of the world's biggest problems. So if we move to the next slide, I think it sort of goes without saying that the past couple of years have been really tough on everyone, whether it's inside of education or higher education or outside. I think we've all experienced some struggles due to the pandemic. And so, you know, we really looked at this a couple of years ago in working with education and in thinking about how our technology could support. We did some research. We do this report called Connected Student Report every year. And this report from last year really showed that supporting student and staff well-being in higher education is critical. And so what we found was that 34% of students said that they need more help managing their course load. And they wanted more, and 40% said that they want their institution to give them more flexible learning options. But even on the staff side, we saw that 76% of staff said that maintaining that work-life balance really became a top challenge for them throughout the pandemic. And I'll give you a bit of a sneak peek, actually. We've got the third edition of this same report coming out. And interestingly, but not, I don't think surprisingly, the requirement to really support student well-being is still on the increase as more students than last year said that they wanted help with their mental health and emotional support. And 36% of students said they need more well-being resources. So it's interesting, as we've been working with higher education institutions globally, and this was a global report, you know, we were hearing this. So really what we're doing at Salesforce is looking at how our technology can support the student well-being initiatives of higher education institutions. How can we use our people, our technology, and our resources to really think of innovative ways to support such a massive challenge, as I said, inside of education and outside as well. So we'll be sharing with you that second edition of the report. The third edition's coming out next month with some additional resources that we published over the past couple of years, specifically on student well-being as well. So I look forward to this discussion and also the questions that you have. As we've been working closely with education institutions, there's several of them on this call as well, on this webinar. So we'll dive deeper into some of the initiatives that have been put into place. But for now, I am going to hand it over to Shanaka from ShareTree, who's been doing some interesting work as well in supporting this same issue. So Shanaka, I'll hand it over to you.
Thanks, Navneet. That was really insightful. And some of the research I'm about to present, I think, will really echo what you guys have found as well. So it's really good to collaborate and join you on this call. So just to introduce ShareTree to this group of people, really our purpose for education institutes and the work that we're doing is as a fully registered charity. So we're here to create an accessible, a sustainable model of mental health, well-being, character and culture for leaders, for educators, students, workplaces and communities. And what we're really here to do is to create a social ecosystem. What we've discovered is that there's so much integration that actually needs to happen from communities to businesses to educational institutes and actually families as well. And so having partnered with the Mental Health Foundation, we're really coming together to bring this research and work to people all around the world. Now, my experience in well-being, mental health and education really comes from a deep passion in understanding the end result of well-being and mental health ignored. So 5 years ago, tragically, I actually lost my younger brother to suicide. When he was just 20 years old, he was in university himself. And what took me a really long time to come to terms with was we genuinely had no idea about the struggle he was going through. And this was before all of that, all the situations with COVID had actually begun. And in the next 5 years, I've seen the challenges of well-being and mental health deteriorating in so many people around me. I've lost many friends and many colleagues to the strains and challenges of mental health. And so really, I'm here today to bring a sense of awareness to how important this topic actually is, because we all love someone and we don't want to lose anyone. And so if we can go to the next slide, what I'll talk to you a little bit about is how this is really being correlated by some of the research that a Google study determined. So Project Aristotle, Google set out to really understand what makes learning environments most effective. And they went into this study with no real intention to measure the importance of psychological safety or mental health or well-being. But what they found was psychological safety was truly at the heart of learning environments and performance more than anything else. To create a culture that was psychologically safe was the springboard that delivered excellence, gave structure, gave clarity, improved career direction, and created an impact that was genuinely purposeful. And then we thought, okay, that's really interesting. Let's do our own research. And so if you go to the next slide, you can see that we did our own research with more than 700 organizations, including 180 educational institutes. And the research I've got here really shows the findings that we had from a leadership perspective and then a prevention perspective. 70% of education leaders across this country reported to have little to no transparency about the mental health of their organization. And then from the user's perspective, people who are trying to check in their emotional state, they found that there was 86% more transparency reported by people who were aware of how they were feeling emotionally every day. 100% of Emotional Pulse leaders reported significant improvement of transparency on who to actually support. And so from a prevention perspective, if you can go to the next button, Adam, 56% of people in their education institute rarely or never had a sense of preventing mental health challenges. But by finding a way to actually check in on a consistent basis creates the difference. And so what we've really found with all the research that we've done with educational institutes from high school to university and then transitioning into the workforce is that it's awareness that's at the heart of this whole issue. And the challenge is being able to be aware and know how people around you are actually feeling. What is the quality of the emotional state of our team, of our students, and how does that affect their ability to perform? So if you can go to the next slide, I invite you to contemplate, how do we actually check in on the emotional state and the morale of our organizations? How do we bring awareness to that? And is it practical to be doing that every single day? How frequently can that actually take place? And so if we go to the next slide, the loss of risk, the level of risk and the loss in performance has a direct correlation to the time taken before intervention. The research we did showed that often these studies and sort of collections of data were happening maybe every 6 months or every year, and it brings really valuable insights. But from a practical perspective, for students who are involved on a day-to-day basis, sometimes that's too long. So what can we do to really strategically have a way of intervening at an early stage in the heart of well-being on the topic of emotional health? So if you can go to the next slide, Adam, is it practical for us to create a system of checking in on everyone every day? We're talking about big institutions here, tens of thousands of people. So it's really about creating systems. We've created a technology, but there's many others out there, but it's integrating systems and software in a way that's simple and effective, bringing in trained support and organizing it in a way where technology is really at your fingertips. So yeah, that's sort of the work that we're doing at the moment with universities. And we've created a software that just allows students to check in really consistently every single day. If you go to the next slide, you can see that the technology is very simple. You basically pulse how you feel every day. You might be feeling strained one day, and then you'll start to notice the trends actually taking place with a little bit of time. So if you go to the next slide, Adam, this is the data we've collected from just one organization here, from the Mental Health Foundation. And we can see that towards the right-hand side, it gives us a really deep insight into how people are feeling. And we can aggregate that data by day, by week, by month, by quarter. We can separate it into different segments as well. And so that data is live data that helps us become aware of what times are particularly challenging and what groups of people most need support throughout their journey. And the impact of this we've also seen as well. So if you go to the next slide, next one after that. Yeah. So the well-being impact we've seen has had a significant improvement and a sustained improvement. We've seen that having the ability just to check in, even without having support available to you, has brought a state of awareness to the emotions that we feel on a day-to-day basis. And what impact does that actually have to our sense of happiness on a day-to-day basis? There's a genuine upwards trajectory over a 30-day period if it's sustained, that sense of awareness over our mental health. If you go to the next slide, we actually did a longitudinal study over 4 years. And again, it showed a sustained improvement in happiness through regular check-ins on emotional health, partnered with support that was available to people who needed it. So with all that said, well-being and emotional pulse is really at the heart of education, performance, but most importantly, life impact. And so what we've got here is the influence and the impact on people throughout their age. And we can see that when dealing with students who are between the ages of 16, perhaps through to 25, is the most significant time outside of primary school and high school where education really has an impact. And so we have the opportunity here to support the future leaders of our community by giving them that sense of support and accessibility through these challenging times. If you go to the next slide, Adam, I'll finish off just the one after that. Just the one after that. Yeah, so I'll finish off by saying that psychologically safe cultures and organizations are really, we believe, at the key to all these other aspects of life that are so important. We speak about the importance of performance, the impact on work, social impacts that we hope these people will have, and then the quality of life that we hope to see in these people as they move through life. But without a sense of well-being at the heart of that, it actually doesn't allow all of those other aspects to flower. So, yeah, I'm really looking forward to the rest of this presentation. I hope this gave a little bit of an insight into some of the research that we've done. And, yeah, thank you, everyone. I'll pass it on for the panel discussion now.
Thank you so much, Shanaka, and for sharing such a very personal story. And I'm sorry for your loss. And it's extraordinary how you've, brought so much to this discussion about well-being. So on that note, I'm going to move into our discussion. Just to let you guys know how this will work, our panel is going to discuss well-being for about half an hour. And then the last 10 minutes or so, we can take questions from the audience. In the bottom right-hand side of your screen, you'll see a Q&A. So if anyone wants to type questions in, there you are. Oh, there's one already. What's the app name? We're going to save up those questions for the end. But yes, please start putting your Q&A there. And if I can ask our panelists to turn on their screens. So the last 2 years have been incredibly challenging. We all know that there have been very strict lockdowns in Australia, New Zealand, other parts of the world. And now students and staff are facing anxiety. They may have fears about upheaval in their work or in their studies, and they may have some financial stresses too. So the first question I'm just going to throw out to our university participants is basically, how do you deal with well-being? What are some of the well-being programs that you have or that you can install? You can just jump in, by the way, if anyone wants to speak.
I'm happy to jump in, Joyce. Oh, no, look, Julie, you go ahead.
Sorry, we're flipping each other at first. I think it's not just one individual thing. So the University of Wollongong has set up a student mental health model which encompasses the entirety of the organisation. So it's critical that you have a university-wide systematic approach to the way in which you deal with this, and that it encompasses the foundational policies, leadership, strategies that you have, the data that you collect, and then moves on up the scales to the services you might provide to all students, to students that are, grappling with mental ill health, and then the way in which we might respond to a student that might be in crisis. So we have a very joined up approach to trying to address that in a way that helps us to be much more coherent as a university.
Thank you very much. Dean, do you want to pop in?
Thank you. Yeah, no, absolutely. And Julia, echoing that sentiment, certainly at RMIT, we have a similar joined up approach. But perhaps to respond to something Shanaka said about psychological safety, I think it's really important that we create that psychologically safe workplace learning environment, and that we have open and constructive and supported conversations about the psychological risks that our staff and our students are engaging with, and then move into opportunities for co-design of solutions and strategies and to address those risks. It may be an app, but it may be as simple as our timetabling or our places and spaces. So often we get some surprising and delightful solutions to addressing psychological risk and building psychological safety just by having that open dialogue with our stakeholders. And I think it's really important that we build the capability and capacity of both our students and our staff, because it is joined up, and it's really important that we are supporting all at the university, and so we can be successful.
Joyce, if I could jump in on something here as well. I think right now, obviously, this is a discussion that's had much prominence and a lot of consideration over the last few years. And I think that for us, we did want to step back and ensure that we met minimum standards. And so our starting point for our frameworks and for our strategies was really the TEXA well-being and safety regulations and the origin reports that were being generated through the support of Universities Australia. I think it's really important for everyone to sort of step back and look and see what's actually there and the guidance that you have. You're not starting from a blank slate.
Thanks, Joyce. I think one of the big shifts in the university space is moving from a mentality of them to us to them, whereas we expect the students to present with their needs, whereas we should be able to identify their needs, perhaps sometimes before they're even recognised. And that can be from markers of things happening in the classroom, but also things happening behaviourally, or even things happening in terms of administrative systems or financial systems and things not being paid. So there's lots of markers in the university databases that we can use to sort of reach out to students, but also connect students with the people who they want to talk to. During the pandemic, I think one of the biggest things that universities have utilised more has been their peers. I know at the University of Sydney, we had a lot more peer support advisors employed, and this was a way to sort of engage with students with who they wanted to engage with, but also as a linking to professional services as well. So in different platforms and different mediums has been really important through the digital space.
Thanks so much, Ben. I think your comment about, you know, them going to us and us going to them is really great. By the way, there's a little raise hand thing if you guys want to raise your hands too and you speak, but you're also welcome to just speak. And I think on that note of the students coming to you and you going to the students, we do have a question about anticipating the well-being concerns of new students. And I think this year is really special because there are a lot of students who were either because they were trapped by the border or even domestically couldn't come in. So you have a lot of new students. Does anyone want to speak about ways that you can anticipate the well-being concerns of students who are coming in for the first time maybe? Oh, Carrie, I see your hand up.
Okay, I would say that we do have a lot of interstate students. And so for us, once we began the return to campus, we did target those who we knew were coming from very heavily locked down states because they had essentially missed out on the year 12 experience. And so they were coming to us and it was almost as though they were frozen in time. Their maturity levels were lacking somewhat. So what we did was we did a lot of introductory socialization free of alcohol in the first instance and tried to get as much mentoring as possible, both face-to-face and through our online mentoring app, just to get them connected. Even prior to arrival, we had them buddied up. Just anything we could do to make that, you know, that leap from, you know, their bedroom or wherever they've been studying for the last 2 years to a real campus.
That's fantastic. We all look forward to our real campuses. Dean, and then after that, Julia, please.
Thanks, Joyce. I feel I need to speak as somebody who resides in one of those more lockdown states for those years. Yes, we have been certainly focusing on supporting our first-year students, but we're equally concerned about our third-year students who've spent the first 2 years of their university lives in their bedrooms, spare rooms, in shared accommodation. And to build on Ben's comments, certainly looking to leverage the power of the peer. So that peer-to-peer connections, it's always easy to go to something with a friend than to go alone. But equally, one of the things that we love about the start of semester is the orientation events and the food trucks and the noises and all of the fun. But of course, for students who have perhaps lacking in social fitness because they've spent 2 years in isolation, we needed to create environments within that fun for the neurodiverse, for the shy, for the socially awkward, for those who just haven't really interacted for the last 2 years as well they might. So we were quite purposeful in our student activation and events, creating moments of intimacy, creating moments where people can do and creating conversation starters. So we really careful to re-support people re-enter real life and support that for both first years, but also for third years. I'll hand it to Julia.
Thank you. Look, I just echo everything that you've said there. And I think there's a real complexity with what we're dealing with. So on the one hand, what we've been striving to do is set up environments where the students can feel comfortable. They see someone that resonates with them, as with the other universities. We've got lots of peer programs so that they may hang out in that space. And then on the third day, they might ask the question that really is at the bottom of what's going on. The other thing is that what we're finding is that the students, and this is not just the commencing, but the students returning into the university environment after 2 years of essentially being in an online and locked down sort of space, they have very little bandwidth in order to be able to do anything that's on the side. So what we've been really striving to do is to work within the curriculum in order to be able to assist those students. And we're finding that we're having, like has already been said, we're having to reintroduce students to the skills of social connectivity, because they've lost a little bit of ground in relation to how to work with each other, how to get along, how to debate, and when it isn't actually a conflict, it's just a disagreement of opinion. So we've had to do a fair bit of work within curriculum to assist students to overcome those. And so what we're striving to do is, where possible, not add things on the side, bring it into the environment that they're studying in. And we're finding that's much more effective.
Thank you, Julia. Navneet, would you like to add something?
Yeah, it's just, you know, it's interesting. I know that the panelists here have not seen the third edition of our research, but it's funny that so much of what you've said is really sort of backed up, and there's that evidence in that third report. So, Dean, I wanted to go back to something that you said just about really involving the students and co-designing some of these things. So one of the questions that we asked in the research was really around, you know, what is it that helps you to choose an institution? And a lot of that came down to well-being, career prospects, and feeling that sense of belonging. So I think what you said about those fairs and what you do during orientation gives students that sense of belonging that they so need, given the gap that they've had and just the gap between obviously interaction and just having that personal one-to-one and face-to-face experience. And so that seems to be what, for me at least, it feels like an opportunity for institutions to really think about some of those upstream solutions, right? As soon as students come in for orientation and things, rather than sort of more downstream solutions and supporting student well-being. Often that's where a lot of students, just thinking back to my own time in education, that's where a lot of students fell through the cracks. So I think there's a really fantastic opportunity when you do stuff at orientation, a great opportunity to support those students early.
Absolutely. And I think the trick that we've found, and it builds on what Julie just said, is baking it into the experience. So leading with inclusive design at every touch point, looking at how do we make this experience more inclusive? So we're not necessarily segmenting the well-being experience. It is part of the whole ecosystem. So looking for those opportunities to delight and engage and involve and, you know, invite.
Thanks, Dean. I'm very jealous because our campuses don't have food trucks. Julia, would you like to add something?
Oh, I was just going to add, the other thing is you look for those opportunities that really resonate with the students. So we're in the middle of a Respect Week, and we've got a whole load of panels, and we were lucky enough to get Grace Tame to come in and run a live streamed event. And it really captured the imagination across the week with the different panels, with the students and staff engaging as a community rather than just a student-facing activity or a staff-facing activity. So we're looking for those sorts of opportunities that really help to draw people in and get people engaged.
I like the idea of the Respect space. I want to ask a little bit, and we've talked about a bit about the hybrid education. And I know before this this talk, we were speaking a little bit about some of the silver linings. I was wondering if you could share some of your experiences with hybrid learning, where, you know, part of it's in person, part of it's online, some of it's mixed. Would anyone like to speak about that hybrid experience? Ben.
Thank you, Joyce. I think the first thing we have to acknowledge that hybrid initially was very difficult for people and continues to be difficult for a lot of students. And some of the major reasons for that is the lack of structure around it. and that it's self-determined. A lot of the times the students are choosing their own schedules to access materials, and it might not feel as compulsory as it used to be. So there's a lot more student-driven behavior than previously. And that's like we all had a calendar today for this event, whereas students might not have a calendar for their events anymore because it's all self-determined, and that makes it very difficult. I don't know if people have ever planned to go to the gym, but it sometimes can get very disruptive if no one is watching you or knowing if you're going to go. But that's what the student space has been like for a couple of years, and it's getting very difficult for them. For others, it's been great because it's been a new way to interact. A lot of students are more comfortable interacting in the digital space, whether it's through comments that are typed in versus spoken in a classroom, and that's been a really big impact for them, but also for them to be able to display skills they've never been able to display before, just because of the types of mediums that have been sort of done, and even the crowdsourced sort of feedback on what's happening within the classroom or within the questions has been really important as well. So anything that encourages the connection to their class or their materials, I think, has been really important for the student perspective.
Muted. Thank you very much. Does anyone have anything else to say about even the pros or the cons of hybrid learning on well-being? Julia?
Oh, I was waiting for Dean because we had a conversation beforehand and he made the point, which was spot on. So I won't steal your thunder, Dean.
Oh, we'll give you a double act. Thanks, Julia. So the point we made was that in some ways, some of our underrepresented disabled or disadvantaged students have really benefited from the online learning environment. So, in particular, students in regional or remote Victoria can now have a choice between travelling on a train 2 hours to come to a lecture or remaining online. Similarly, for some of our neurodiverse students, that they can self-regulate, self-manage by being in that online environment. One of the not so good examples from COVID, what we discovered in our online learning environments, and as Ben said, we kind of pivoted very, very quickly to the online environment. Unfortunately, we weren't set up to allow students to indicate their preferred name. So for some of our trans or non-binary students, we were dead naming them in their learning environment, which was not our intention. That then obviously triggered a response to then address that. But so we're just really mindful now of, we've always had DDA compliance around our physical environments. How are we making sure that our online environments are safe and inclusive and supportive? So some lessons learned, but some great opportunities for students. Oh, and sorry, also postgraduates, the people with childcare responsibilities could now, perhaps different to Ben's point, but those who didn't want the structure, those who do want to do learning on demand, were now able to do so as well. So it did open up a level of access to participation for groups that perhaps traditionally weren't engaging with that on-campus experience. Julia.
Thank you. So the tag teaming, which is great. And part of this is that all the services were online as well. So we have a large number of students that would previously not maybe have accessed those services, but because they're online and if you're having a difficult day, they could engage in a teleconsult, telehealth or tele-peer success coaching or all those sorts of programs that we had. From their bedroom or from in their gym jams, you know, so they didn't have to get up and didn't have to go out. And I think that was really, really helpful. I think in this, we're now facing a bit of complexity as we come into a let's everyone come back onto campus, because we're now grappling with how do you retain that flexibility for these students? How do you retain that environment that has been a real game changer for particularly for our students with disability and still enable the students to engage in an on-campus experience? So this has been something that's been we're working through as we go into this new year.
Thank you very much. Carrie, did you want to add something?
Just on a final note, I'm not sure if anyone had seen this article in yesterday's paper that was talking about professors on Twitter and other social media platforms sharing empty lecture halls as they were standing in front. And I do think that there is a danger that, you know, without clear messaging on the expectations of our students, do we want you there? Or are we saying it's a free for all and you do whatever you want? As long as you do it well and you do it clearly and the communication is effective, fine. But if the expectation is that I'm putting a lecture in front of a row of seats, and nobody's showing up, and likewise, they're not tuning in, then is the learning going on? I don't know, but I think that we're grappling with that now, how we communicate our expectations to the students and what it means for them moving forward.
Thank you. It seems like there's a lot of, Dean, please pop in.
Sorry, I feel I just need to extend on that point. The other thing, and we're talking about well-being for our entire community, teaching and learning in a hybrid environment can put extra strain, work demands on our academics, our educators. So we need to be really mindful as we open up that learning experience for a more diverse cohort of learners, how are we supporting our educators to make sure they are remaining psychologically safe and on top of the game? Just want to make that point.
Yes, absolutely, because we're talking about well-being for everyone on campus, staff, academics, students, because it is a community and they interact, of course. Julia, would you like to add something?
Yeah, it's just on this point, because that sort of complexity of potentially having a lecture with the cameras off, so with all the cameras off and someone's trying to be in an environment like that, it's tough for the academics. We set up a student staff partnership innovation hub. We brought students and staff to co-design principles around how we might address this. So I think it goes back to that point that we were making very early in the piece, that with some of these problems that we're grappling with, it's working in partnership with the students in order to better understand what might be the principles that we can adopt and how might we move it forward, because the world has shifted and we are in a changed environment.
Thank you very much. I mean, one of the issues, I know this could go on for hours. One of the issues we wanted to talk about was how to bring students into the process. So you're right, it's not like the university says this is our initiative and there you go. We have a embarrassment of riches in the Q&A space. So if you guys don't mind, I might actually move to some of these questions because they're very related to what we're talking about. I'm just gonna go through them. From an anonymous person, pivoting to an online environment has presented problems around student well-being in terms of identifying markers that might be more apparent in a face-to-face environment. And does anyone on the panel have advice, so I guess, on how to identify issues when your students are remote?
I like data, but I think there's lots of different types. There's lots of different types of data you can use. The most obvious from an academic's perspective is whether they've actually accessed the learning materials. That's from an underutilization, but then there can be an overutilization as well. So I think in a lot of the learning management systems, you can see people are accessing it multiple times, but at unusual times as well. Like they might be going in at 3 a.m. when they're accessing the system, but they are in Australia, and that could be a sign that something may not be going quite well there. From a university perspective, it could be, hey, this person's had 30 requests for special consideration and they're all different. They're not all related to COVID or being close contacts. They're all different things. And there is perhaps a sort of a sign of an ongoing need and a need to register for inclusion or disability support. So I think there's need to be use of systems in a smart way that you do have flags when people go past certain markers, and just trust the system that we can talk to each other to sort of best support the students at the right time. The last thing is having a way in the digital space that staff can refer, because when people were off campus, a lot of universities struggled with how are we going to get staff connected with support staff. And by having dedicated forms or teams to receive support requests from staff was a really important thing to lessen the sort of distress in those first responders who might be staff.
Thank you very much. Those are three really great suggestions. Carrie, would you like to add some more advice for this participant?
Just as Ben was articulating his last, I put my hand up before Ben articulated his last point, because that's precisely what we've instituted, is a well-being reporting system, which has really gone great guns, and it allows us to know, as an academic, if you do have a concern, you can report it, and our well-being team will definitely begin a care process for that student. And whether it's a process of discovery, that, you know, or just as simple as a conversation, these are the things that we've noted in your behaviors. Do you need help? Do you need support? What would you like? How can we make your journey easier? And again, it goes back to that notion of holistic thing. So our big thing is getting people aware of that capacity to report and what the mechanism that will launch for the student and for the academic.
Thank you, Carrie. You've kind of answered the second question, or segued into it, which is, hi, do you have any suggestions for implementing well-being within a staff setting, especially during peak hours, when there's very little time to focus on anything but our students? Julia.
Look, I think this is actually very critical. And I think in some respects, the online environment has been slightly problematic, particularly with COVID. So you have staff who are working in an online environment, then get an infection, and then are still working. And so because you can work, they do work. So I think there is a really clear and explicit messaging around getting the balance right, maintaining the boundaries, really striving to remember that they have all the leaves available to them. So should they need it, they can take special leave, they can take sick leave, they have annual leave. And so I think it's really reminding people of those things. With the ebb and flow of the peak, again, it's really a matter of people being reflective and tuned in. So it's running sort of mechanisms within the university that help staff to pick up on the fact that they may not be giving themselves a breather, that they may not be switching things off at times, and giving them permission to turn things off, because I think particularly academics tend to continue to work and work all the hours, and that's not a good habit.
Yes, I totally agree with that. Ben, would you like to add something about staff well-being? Oh, are you muted? I think you're muted.
Oh, sorry, apologies. I think the simplest one is bump in and bump out time. Like at universities, it was always very well accepted that you'd start at 5 past the hour and finish at 5:02, just so people could travel. People don't do that in the digital world when they've got meetings or events, and pushing the session to the last minute can really be critical in terms of the well-being, or just having those incidental conversations that would be really important for the person to sort of debrief or just collect themselves before moving to the next activity. And we just need to allow that space for staff to sort of collect themselves between events.
Yes, we all could use that 5 minute break. Navneet, would you like to add something?
Yeah, it's more, I guess, for, as a Salesforce employee, things that the company have done for us just during the pandemic, which, as I've been talking to higher education institutions, not all of this is too different, but maybe, you know, not all are doing it. One is, on Friday, we just had a well-being day. So what they introduced for all employees globally was one well-being day a month that was sort of set out at the beginning of the calendar year, so you knew exactly, you know, this was a day for you to do something for your well-being and just take that space out so that everyone felt like they were getting a break. The other one was just making sure that we've got regular access to resources around well-being. So Thrive Global is somebody that the company partnered with to make sure we've got regular resources, whether that's a 5 minute mindfulness break in the middle of a day, optionally join that. Here's a, you know, a booklet on some other exercises, and just getting a pulse check on how staff are doing through surveys has been something else that's been implemented, which I think has been fantastic, and really helped us as employees really take care and check in on our own well-being, especially if you've got kids and things like that, you know, just making sure that you're getting that work-life balance.
Absolutely. Julia.
I was just going to add, and just on what you were just saying there, it's having fun as well. So I think there are opportunities, and what we're finding with people coming back on campus, although we've got a sort of a rolling schedule of people on and off campus and doing things like that, that connectivity has been super important to people's well-being, because you spot things when you're talking to someone in person that you may not spot in an online environment. So it's using those opportunities to really connect with each other and to genuinely ask how you're traveling, how are things going, and to do that in an environment where people feel safe, they feel respected, and if you can, where you've got environments where they feel like they're having some fun as well, which I think lightens the mood.
Great. Well, we have a lot of questions, or two related questions. One from Sarah: how do you get students most at risk to engage with the services? And then I think in a related question from Genevieve is, how about students who don't have a lot of bandwidth for extras, optional extras? And an interesting point, can we embed well-being initiatives within the course credits? And on that note, I'm gonna pass to Dean.
Thanks for that. I'll get to course credits in a moment. That's a contested space. But if I think about identifying students at risk, like Ben, I love my data Dean, I sometimes get called. But using your data across various touch points and data sets to work out who the students are who are potentially at risk. The other thing I would say is, in the university environment, we've got quite good at the treatment and care part of the continuum. We're getting better at the early intervention, but we've really, as a result of COVID, put a lot more focus now on prevention and promotion. So moving to the left on that stepped care process and looking at how can we avoid the need for students to become at risk and then to need that high touch critical care and treatment. So really leveraging the power of the peers, like I've said, looking at destigmatizing help seeking behaviors, looking at building psychological capital and resilience. So really focusing on preventing them from becoming at risk, but using your data to also raise awareness of the pathways to care. As an example, last week, and I'm sure other universities did this, we wrote out to our 500 students who we are aware are Sri Lankan. So we wrote out to them and Pakistani actually, to advise them to a note of empathy and concern for what's happening in their home country, a note about the services that we have available, and then a call to action if they need support. What we are now going to do is watch that data against those who opened the email, who didn't open the email, and do outbound phone calls from peers to then support. So flipping the model, not waiting for them to come to us, but reaching out to them as a peer to say, let's have a chat. And they may not need high touch support. They may just need a friend or someone to talk to or to connect in with one of our student clubs. So flipping the model is some of the things that we've been trying to do at RMIT. Oh, and in terms of in the curriculum, wow. There's a lot of things that we'd like to get into the curriculum. Whether we can get wellbeing in, it would be a challenge. The curriculum's already quite crammed in some spots, but certainly having those conversations and those environments where we are being inclusive and supportive, I think helps. Whether it's Zen for credit, that's a whole different story and can get a little bit challenging. But I see my colleagues have much more to add to that, so I'll hand over to Julia.
Thanks, Dean. And look, echo all the things that you were just saying about that proactivity and leaning in, and how do you really sort of put in place opportunities where students are engaging in things without even knowing that we're actually getting in there to try and find out about their wellbeing. With respect to the curriculum, there's a remarkable amount of elements within the curriculum already that address social connectivity, people's ability to engage with others and to do a whole range of things. I think where we're perhaps, what we haven't capitalized on as a sector is really making explicit what's implicit in curriculum rather than just trying to cram extra bits in, because that's the problem, the crowded curriculum space that we're having. But there are some programs like the BRITE program, for instance, which is the Building Resilience in Teacher Education, where they've actually inbuilt into the program resilience and elements within it, such that as the people qualify and go out into the workforce, they're better equipped for the work environment as well as better equipped for the study environment whilst they're doing the course. So I think there are some good examples that we can pick up on.
I was just going to say, in terms of opportunities for the curriculum, I think one of the biggest things that's come in is a lot more self-reflection. And what I've noticed as well is when there's self-reflection assessments, there's less chance for academic integrity issues, because it's all about their experience and from their perspective. So I know actual academics are using that sort of tool to overcome academic integrity issues, but also it does allow for the individuals to reflect on their personal journeys through a unit, but also across time as well, and how they'll use it in their personal development.
Carrie, did you want to add something to this?
Yeah, I mean, from a curriculum standpoint, that as everyone has articulated, it's a very crowded space, but you can find ways. Typically, universities will have their touchstone units or their basic core units. Here at Bond, we have something called Beyond Bond that has our four core modules, and certainly they've been reshaped in recent years to include a lot more of a conversation around self-efficacy and resiliency, and just the inclusion in there to ensure that we present these concepts and begin the dialogue with students.
Thank you very, very much. I like, Dean, what you said about Sri Lanka, because, and that answers one of the questions we have here from Rohini, which is how do you have systems to engage with offsite or international students? I have a quite specific question from Tom. Has anyone established baseline measures to ascertain well-being of students? Because I know several of you have already talked about data and using data. And if so, what measures have you found helpful? So Ben, would you like to take that on?
As part of our strategy, we're actually just about to launch this, and we're just about to do an SMS-based study. So, and to ask one simple question of students at different points in the year. So that's to SMS every student, ask them one question and ask them to respond on a scale of 0 to 10 about their satisfaction with university life and wellbeing. So just have one question based. The reason for that is it is a large cohort of students and wanting to get as much representative sample as possible. And the data that we've had from other studies is that you can get a response rate of over 90% if you use SMS. So that's why we're going down that pathway.
Thank you. And for you, Dean, do you have something to add about using the data? Yep.
Absolutely. And I think response rate to surveys is, if we can crack that from students, again, contested space, SES, your CES, your GOS, all these surveys that are happening, your sexual assault, sexual harm surveys. One of the things that RMIT introduced last year was a psychosocial risk survey of staff and students. We're doing it in partnership with the University of South Australia, and it's being run by Professor Maureen Dollard, for those of you familiar with Maureen's work, but it's looking at psychosocial safety risks. So we established a baseline last year. We're repeating that survey now, and it's really giving us some really rich insights into what we can do to support our staff and our students move from a languishing state into a thriving state. But the key is getting people to respond to that survey and getting that data. But at least we're moving in the right direction, I think, because data is a gift, and it helps us then to focus on what we need to do to improve the experience for all.
Julia, would you like to add about the using the data?
Yeah, it's just echoing that. So we've got two things that we're doing. So one is we did a body of research to build the student mental health model, and that took us 2.5 to 3 years to actually build the framework and how we were going to approach it. We ran the inaugural student mental health survey, and we picked the most stressful time, right in the middle of, at the end of a long lockdown in November during exams last year. So that was our foundation baseline survey. We're running it again this year, and we do the analysis of that. And then we have a data working party that's getting together to try and look for not necessarily the data that we think is already logically going to show us where there might be some issues, but we're really trying to do that sort of triangulation across the data to find out where there are some less obvious signals, because like the other universities, what we're striving to be is as proactive as possible. So how do you lean in? And sometimes lean in with an innocuous, how are you traveling? It's week 5, it's a difficult time. Not necessarily you've picked up on one of our data sets and we're worried about you type questions. So there's all those other mechanisms of when you do spot something, how do you then react to it? So that's what we're doing.
Navneet.
Yeah, Joyce, I quickly just wanted to just add to this one, again, in the spirit of solutions here, what we really worked on at the beginning of the pandemic was how our technology could help bring that data together. So Ben earlier referenced, indicators from the LMS. I think there are so many other systems as well that give good indicators of how students might be feeling, whether it's a student information system and what's logged there, or whether they're accessing LMS, or any other emails and things that have been sent. So what our platform really does is bring those systems together. So if you're, in any one of these roles, if you are Ben, if you are Julia, if you're a Dean, you're getting that full holistic picture of how students are actually doing. So you're not having to spend all this time in different systems Rather, you're actually getting to spend time with getting the full picture of students and really focusing on what matters, which is their well-being. And the same applies for staff as well. So that was just sort of one big part of the solution. And somebody mentioned resilience earlier. Julia, it might have been you. Just, you know, with our online learning platform as well, with My Trailhead, there is a host of well-being resources that we as employees used that we wanted to make sure that our higher ed partners knew about, that you could also build, you know, easily build these sort of questions and courses and just fun activities to make students, to help students build that resilience over time, so that the only time that they're getting help is not when they're already down, downstream, as I was saying, going down a track that's maybe not good, rather just giving them the resources up front, you know, to help them to build that strength and build that resilience so that they hopefully don't need more of those services downstream.
Thank you very much. We're running down the clock, so I only have one question, which I know you guys can't answer in the 3 minutes we have left, but we have a question from Gavin. What's your top tips for creating a whole of university approach? Top tips, anyone? From Julia.
I'd say it's twofold. One is you need to have an evidence base, because you've got to get the university on board. So it has to be evidence-based and contextually bound to the university. The second thing is senior leadership buy-in. So you really do need senior leadership buy-in, and then that helps to drive the whole thing.
Thank you. Carrie, some top tips?
Lots and lots of outreach. I can't even count the number of sessions we held where we shared our new reporting systems and mechanisms and had to do a lot of pitching to faculty and to other administrative areas.
And Ben, do you have any top tips for our audience?
Don't define well-being as one thing. Don't define it as mental well-being. Don't define it as physical well-being. Academic well-being, it has to be part of everything, including employment well-being and financial well-being. Like, there has to be all those, that picture has to be very holistic, and you have to be very open. If someone's got an issue or a complaint, it might stem from a well-being issue, or it might stem from a way the systems have created a well-being issue for the student because of the way the university is working. So you need to look at it from a full-on perspective.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that we so appreciate all of the questions, and we can't get to all of them. And they are about really interesting topics like hybrid learning and more about well-being and staff and students. But we're going to wrap up. So as we close, I want just to let you know that we will continue these conversations. And also that we have some resources. Can you all see the slide? These resources for participants, we will reach out to you after the event. And then when you get the slide, you will be able to download and read a little bit more about student well-being and some of the reports and the studies that we've done. We will save your questions, by the way. I would like to thank all of our panelists for being here and all of our 100 plus participants for being here. I think we all know how important well-being is for staff and for students. So Ben, Julia, Navit, Dean, Carrie, Shanaka, thank you so much for joining us today.